Look at that picture up there. One day, we're going to get a bona fide hug from the carpenter. You're going to feel him squeeze back as you squeeze him. And you're going to have the experience that John the Beloved had as he listened to the heartbeat of God there in the upper room, leaning up against his chest. It's really going to happen. One thing I want to say before we proceed with the rest of the program. Last night, we talked about spending some quality time alone with God in His Word. And I want to acknowledge that there are people, both young and old, who find it challenging to read. And yet they've managed to do very well in life, but they just have some challenges with reading for a variety of different reasons. And sometimes they ask us after meetings, you know, this thing about taking time in the Bible, it's kind of a big challenge for me, and I'm wondering, what can I do to have that kind of time? And the answer that I'd like to offer you is there are a variety of other ways to meditate on the Word of God besides actually reading it word for word. For example, those pictures that we were just showing as we sang that song all come from a thing called the Matthew video or the Matthew DVD. Every word of the entire film is word for word the gospel according to Matthew in the NIV version. And as you watch and listen, you can see and hear the Bible being read. And you can have the added benefit of being able to meditate. You're stimulated with your meditation as you see things happening that kind of prompt you to. And you can hit that thing on pause and then just think about it. Go over the same kind of process that we talked about, SOAP, while you watch it on there. And you can get the Gospel of John. You can get the Gospel of the Book of Acts. You can get, there's a number, and you can get the Bible on audio, too. You can listen to the Bible on an audio CD. You can listen to the Bible where someone's reading it. You can listen to the Bible when it's read with extra sound effects, like when Jesus is on the water and he's calming the storm. You can hear the wind kind of going as he says what he says in Scripture. So there's a variety of ways that a person can still meditate on the Word of God, even if they find reading challenging. And let me tell you one more thing that I've done myself. I have a sister who was born with a learning disability. They told my parents when she was 6 years old that she would never have mental capacity that would exceed about a 9 or 10 year old. And now she's 52. And if my sister can spend time every morning with a children's Bible, I think just about everybody can find some way to meditate even on a few verses. She has precious time with Jesus, and I took a note from her, I took a cue from her. I purchased a children's picture Bible with brief words under each picture. Got it at the ABC, and I went through that whole Bible as a personal devotional for myself, morning by morning, and I found out that just by looking at those pictures and reading those few words with the prayer that God would unpack that passage for me, that my mind and my heart were deeply blessed. And so there's a lot of ways, and just wanted to encourage you, if reading's a challenge, you can still find ways to have quality time with Jesus. I'd like to have one more prayer. I get down on my knees. I get on my knees because it just really, really matters to me tonight, Lord. It matters every night, but it matters to me tonight that I would be able to talk about prayer in a way that would just maybe stimulate some of us to experience a new or fresher mode of communication with you. I know I can't make any statements of value if your Holy Spirit doesn't anoint me. So I pray for anointing right now, and I pray for that same anointing for every person. I want the anointing to be heavy. I want it to begin right now. I want it to continue throughout this next few minutes, so I'm asking for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you were paying attention to the kids feature, you were reminded once again of the three legs of the stool. Bible study for the purpose of getting to know God, that was last night. Prayer for the purpose of communion, which is going to be our theme for tonight. Tomorrow night, spilling over, sharing with others what you're learning in the first two. These are the three legs of the relationship stool. And we've been trying to make a very strong presentation or case for the idea that relationship with Jesus is the core of the Christian life. It's the heart of the matter. As we said earlier, it's like if you don't have this component going, well, it's kind of like trying to have a dairy farm without cows. It's not going to be very successful. So we're focusing on the relationship stool. Now tonight, the subject of prayer. Many years ago, when I was in fifth grade, we were living in a little town called Grand Junction, Colorado. I loved that town, and while I was living there, we got a stereo. Does anybody remember what a stereo is? Yeah, I'm old enough to remember. And in our house where we had that stereo, we would put these things that looked like black pizza. And we'd stick it in there, and it would go around and around. And if I got too rambunctious and started kind of making too much racket near that stereo, the thing would go, and I'd be instructed to find another place to play. But while we were listening to records, there was a one in particular that I really enjoyed. It was by Jim Reeves. Does anybody remember Jim Reeves? A Southern gospel singer. Well, he had an album called My Cathedral, and on that album he recited a poem that he had written, and while he recited the poem he had Sweet Hour of Prayer playing in the background. It made such an impact on me that even as a little fifth grader, I guess it just lodged permanently on my hard drive. It was called The Farmer and the Lord, and I want to share it with you as a launch into the presentation. So here goes. The Farmer and the Lord. While traveling one evening by the side of the road, I saw an old farmer in a field he'd just mowed. His face was all brown and wrinkled by the wind, but he was talking to the Lord just like you'd be talking to a friend. "Well, sir," he said in a voice calm and quiet, "them corn tassels need a sacking, but I got no string to tie it. Had no rain in so long that the fields are mighty dusty, and it's been so unbearable hot that the kids are even getting fussy. Now that grass down in the pasture, it should be knee high. Why, if we could just have a little shower, Lord, might keep the cow from going dry. Ah, but listen to me talk. Why, you'd think I wasn't grateful. Why, if you didn't know me so well, Lord, you'd think I was downright hateful. You'd think I'd forgot about the new calf that you sent and the money in the mail that took care of the rent. Ma's cold is better, and Johnny's home from the Navy, and that great Sabbath dinner with mashed potatoes and gravy. The new preacher you sent us, Lord, he sure is a fine young man. Why, he's just converting them sinners to beat the band. Well, guess I'll be moseying along, Lord. Won't take no more of your time. Guess there's plenty folks hereabouts waiting to ring your line. So, evening to you, Lord, and watch over us tonight. And we won't worry about nothing, Lord, because with you, everything's always going to be all right. Farmer and the Lord. Sweet Hour of Prayer. Can you see why I never forgot that poem? Talking to God just like you'd be talking with a friend. You know, there are seminars that you can attend and books you can read that talk about how to get answers to prayer. Tonight, we're going to take a little bit of a different view and twist, and we're going to consider that prayer is the answer. The answer is prayer. The fact that we have the ear of heaven, the fact that when we dial that number, God pays attention, is answer in itself, regardless of what happens after that. The answer is prayer. There are a number of gems that I have loved to read and reread over and over and have written down and keep them with me. And thought I'd just share two or three of them with you as we kind of start right this one. So Steps to Christ, page 96 is the first one. Through sincere prayer, we are brought into connection with the mind of God, the mind of the infinite. We may have no remarkable evidence at the time that the face of our Redeemer is bending over us in compassion and love, but this is even so. We may not feel his visible touch, but his hand is upon us in love and pitying tenderness. Even if we don't feel it, it's there. That's a gem. Here's another one. Same book. Steps to Christ. Keep your wants, your joys, your sorrows, your cares, your fears before God. That's a pretty broad palette. You cannot burden him. You cannot weary him. I'm going to finish that paragraph in a minute, but I just want to pause for a moment about that. You cannot weary him. Maybe some of you can remember. I remember watching a film that we love to watch. We've watched it over and over. It's called Anne of Green Gables, a wholesome film about a little orphan girl who gets adopted by a spinster and her bachelor brother. And they're getting on in years, and they think they're going to be adopting a boy to help with the farm. And Matthew, I think his name, I think I wrote it down so I wouldn't say it wrong. Let's see where it is here. Cuthbert. Matthew is the elderly brother who comes in to pick up Anne at the train station. Now, Anne is a cute little girl who doesn't ever quit talking. And she climbs up into the buggy with Matthew. He said, "I thought it was going to be a boy." And she said, "Oh, I hope you aren't disappointed." And he says, "Well, you know, get in." And then they start to go down the lane, and Matthew's driving. And oh my, Anne just chatters and chatters and chatters and chatters. And finally, all of a sudden, and Matthew, of course, he doesn't say a word. He's quiet to start with, but he couldn't have gotten a word in if he'd wanted to. And all of a sudden, Anne says to Matthew, she says, "Am I talking too much? I've been told I talk too much. I can be quiet. I really can. Am I talking too much?" And Matthew looks at her with a smile, and he says, "You can talk all you want. I don't mind." And she hooks her hand through his arm, and she scoots a little closer, and she says, "Oh, I'm going to like you." Back to that verse. You cannot weary him. "Lord, I've said this to you a dozen times. If I've said it to you once," he says, "you can talk all you want. I don't mind. Take to him everything that perplexes the mind. Nothing is too great for him to bear. Nothing is too small for him to notice. There is no chapter in our experience too dark for him to read. There is no perplexity too difficult for him to unravel. No calamity can befall the least of his children. No anxiety harass the soul. No joy cheer. No sincere prayer escape the lips of which our Heavenly Father does not take immediate notice." Would you call that a gem? I'd call that a gem. The relations between God and each soul are as distinct and full as though there were not another soul upon the earth. Wow. I don't understand that. My mind can't absorb that truth. But then I'm mortal. I'm a creature. I'm finite. And he's God, and he's creator. And he said, this is the way it is. So, even though I can't understand it, I think it's precious. One more gem, Christ Object Lessons, page 174. Amid the anthems of the celestial choir, Now, do you suppose the celestial choir would sound pretty good? Oh, my. And if you were listening to the celestial choir, do you think you would be easily distracted while they were singing? I doubt it. But it says here that amid the anthems of the celestial choir, God hears the cries of the weakest human being. So imagine him attending choir rehearsal, and all of a sudden you dial his number, and he says, Gabe, I'll be back in a few. Got to get this call. And he slips out because you called. Amid the anthems of the celestial choir, God hears the cries of the weakest human being. Nothing can drown the soul's desire. It rises above the din of the street, above the confusion of the multitude, to the heavenly courts. It is God to whom we are speaking, and our prayer is heard. Wow. I just think that's such a gem. Our prayer is heard. Now, our kids, 29 and 28, have left home. They're both still single, so please send pictures and emails. We'll do what we can. But when they left, Margie and I have looked for all kinds of ways to keep in touch. Of course, there's the regular old landline telephone. Then there's the cell phone. Then there's snail mail, where you use the post office and a stamp. Then there's email. And we have another thing we call MSN Messenger. It's a little chat screen that pops up if they're on the internet. When we're on the internet, all of a sudden I'm working on a sermon, and all of a sudden all a little blurb comes up and says, yo, Dad, are you around? And I say, yeah, Chris, what's going on? And we have a chat right there, just like that. Now, the thing about all those different forms of communication that we use is that it's not monologue. It's dialogue. If it was monologue, it wouldn't be very interesting. Boring, boring, boring. I think my children would tell you that if I was the monologue. They'd say, you know, can we get a word in edgewise? We didn't call just to hear you talk. We want to talk too. Dialogue. That's what makes communication, right? Do you realize that the Bible premise is that God wants to talk with us? He does. He wants to talk with us. That's dialogue. I mentioned it the other day. Far too often our prayers have been one way. We say our prayers, right? Say them. Say our prayers. And when we're done saying our prayers, what do we say? Amen. It's kind of like putting a period and closing the door. Meanwhile, God is wanting to communicate with us. Well, you say, if he wants to communicate, how come I'm not hearing more from him? Let him speak up. You know, the Bible really does say this. John 14, 21. Jesus said it. I will love him and I will manifest myself to him. So he's saying, there's stuff I want to share from my own heart with you. I want to. I'd love to. Psalms 46:10 gives us a little idea maybe why we don't hear more. Be still, it says. And then what? Know that I am God. Could that be a clue? Might we hear more from him if we were still longer? I remember 1 Kings 19:12, where Elijah had been running. You remember God had used him. He called down fire from heaven, consumed the altar and the whole bit, you know, and then the false prophets, 400 of them, were destroyed. And then shortly after that, rain came. And shortly after that, he runs with superhuman energy. 18 miles, I believe it was, although I'm not positive on the number there. But he runs in front of the king's chariot and leads the horses through the blinding rain all the way back to the palace. I'd call that a whole day full of supernatural in empowerment. And then he gets to the palace, and Jezebel says, get this word to Elijah. By this time tomorrow, he's dead meat. And Elijah takes off running from the head of women's ministries. He races across the desert, wishes he could die. En route, he's fed by angels. Finally, he gets to a cave on a mountainside, and we pick it up there. The Lord, he's wondering, if the Lord going to meet him? There was a terrific wind, and he wonders, but the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake, there was a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. After the fire, there was a still, small voice. When God comes, he comes quietly on the wings of doves. And the voice says, "What are you doing here, Elijah? Be still and know that I am God." Desire of Ages, page 668 says, "If you come to him in faith, he will speak his mysteries to you personally." Now, does that sound like monologue or dialogue prayer? That sounds like dialogue, doesn't it? Our hearts will occasionally burn within us. Okay, you're watching. I know you guys watch because several people saw the mistake in scripture last night. Our hearts will often burn within us as one draws near to do what? Commune. Does that sound like monologue or dialogue? Dialogue. To commune with us as he did with Enoch of old. We think about Enoch, you know, he walked with God. And we think that was so wonderful. A little kid in Sabbath school was once asked to explain what happened to Enoch, and he said it this way. He said, well, Enoch and God used to go for long walks, and they'd talk together. And one day, as they were walking, they just talked and talked and talked, and they walked so far while talking that God finally said to Enoch, "Hey, it looks like we're closer to my place than yours. You want to come home with me?" And Enoch said, "I'm there." And that's how it all happened. And but you know, we think that was wonderful for Enoch. It said, that little passage I just put up on the screen, it said he would do that with us too. Enoch didn't have a monopoly on that. He would do it with us. Often our hearts would burn within us as he comes close to commune with us as he did with Enoch of old. Well, you say, if that's true, then why am I not hearing more from him? Go ahead. Let him talk. I want to hear. I'd love to hear. And I'm thinking, maybe one of the reasons we don't hear more from him could be illustrated by this little. When I was in fifth grade again, same grade when I learned that Jim Reeves poem, we went to a little Seventh-day Adventist church school, and when we needed a substitute teacher, we always got Grandma Perkins. Oh, Grandma Perkins was just a delight. She's about 5 foot tall, probably weighed about 85 or 90 pounds. She had gray hair up in a bun on her head. She wore a long dress that came down to about here. She was so full of vim and vigor and vitality and bounce and zip and pep. You wouldn't have been a bit surprised if she did cartwheels or handsprings. It just, you know, it's just amazing. She was in her 80s, and she talked with a southern accent. Y'all this, y'all that. And it was just, we loved to hear her talk. And she kind of had the same gift that Anne of Green Gables had. She could really go. Oh, we loved her. I think maybe I could describe her where some of you would understand best if I said she could have been the twin sister to a little lady known as Granny on the Beverly Hillbillies. They were like two peas in a pod. Grandma Perkins was so cool. She would come out at recess, and she wouldn't supervise and blow a whistle when it was time to come back in. No, she would play with us. Grandma Perkins would play baseball with us. Grandma Perkins would play shortstop in her 80s. Now, she had an advantage because she had that long dress, and she would put her mitt down like this and spread her legs. So if her mitt didn't get it, her dress would. It's like a backstop, you know? And then she would shout at the pitcher, "Let him hit, Johnny, let him hit." And then she'd shout at the batter, "Come on, Billy, you hit it to me, you're dead meat." And Billy would hit it. And if it went anywhere near Grandma Perkins, he was dead meat. Because if her mitt didn't get it, her dress stopped it, she'd reach down, pick it up, and she threw me out at first. I know she could do it. Well, she was a lot of fun. And we loved to listen to her talk. One day, One night, my dad, who was pastoring that church, came home, and he was chuckling as he came in the door. I said, "What's so funny? What are you laughing about?" He said, "Well, I just came from a pastoral visit, and I went to see Grandma Perkins and her husband, Joe." And I said, "And that's what you're laughing at?" "Well, yeah," he said, "something funny happened there." He said, "We were sitting in the front room, and Grandma Perkins was doing the talking. And she was saying how even though she was in her mid-80s, if she could have her druthers, she would be right now, she would be a missionary deep in the heart of the darkest jungle she could find on the planet." But she pointed to her husband. She said, "But that old Joe of mine, he ain't got no romance left in him. None." And my dad looked over at Joe, and Joe went. And then Joe said these words to my dad. He said, "Have you noticed my wife's speech impediment?" Dad said, "No." "Oh, yes," said Joe. "She has to stop for breath." And I wonder if it might not be like that with God. We say our prayers, and then we say amen, and then we're up and we're heading out the door, and meanwhile God is saying, but I was just, I wanted to say, "Oh, maybe tomorrow they'll be still and know what I wanted to share with them." John 10. "The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name, and he leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice." Now, how do the sheep get to know the shepherd's voice? The kids got that answer just a few minutes ago, I heard. Sheep get to know the shepherd's voice by being regularly in his presence. And if you've ever had somebody call on the phone that you haven't seen for 20 years, and they say, "Bet you don't know who this is," and you peg it, you say, "Yes, I do," and you say who they are, and they say, "How did you do that?" You know, you say, "I spent too much time around you years ago to ever forget your voice." See, the reason the sheep know the shepherd's voice is because they've been regularly in his presence. Clue number two. First clue was be still. Clue number two, you've got to be regularly in the shepherd's presence if you ever expect to hear his voice. So, one more reason for the three-legged stool, relationship stool. Regularly in his presence. This evening we're going to look at seven mediums of expression that God uses to communicate. There are many more than seven, but we're going to just look at seven in particular. Mediums of expression that he will use to communicate with us if we are listening for his voice. But before we do, I want to just put in a little plug for something that many of you know already, but it's called prayer journaling. Just a little word about this. Prayer journaling, it's sort of a way of recording your prayers and God's responses. Now you can do that with sketch with a pen or a paper or computer or a notebook or a typewriter, or you know, any number of ways, whatever works for you. And the way you record it could be sketchy notes, or it could be lengthy paragraphs. Just depends on your personality and such. But there are a number of built-in benefits to keeping a prayer journal, and I just want to highlight two or three of those benefits. First of all, they record, keep a record, of interactions that we're having with God that enable us to go back and read them later and be refreshed. Do you remember when Israel was going to go through the Jordan River just before taking Jericho? And God instructed Joshua to have the leaders pick stones up from the riverbed and then stack them on the other side. And God said to Joshua, "Here's the deal. You stack that pile of stones on the other side, and from here on out, anytime your children or strangers or anybody asks you, 'What's the deal with the stones?' you tell them, 'Those are stones of remembrance.'" Stones of remembrance. Those stones are there to remind us of all the things that God did in bringing us out of bondage in Egypt and delivering us to the promised land. Stones of remembrance. And if you keep record of interaction that you're having with God over time, as you go back over it, there are stones of remembrance to strengthen your faith. All of us have ups and downs in our walk. There are times when we're in a flat desert, arid and dry. Other times it's springtime and the flowers are blooming. But you know, when you're in an arid time, it's wonderful to get out your prayer journal and begin refreshing yourself with the way that God has stayed with you. You know, we've been told we have nothing to fear for the future, save we forget how God has stayed with us in the past. And a prayer journal records ways in which he has stayed with you and gives you courage. I remember reading about George Mueller. I'm sure most of you are familiar with him. A wonderful story. I think if the Bible had been written in the last 200 years, there would be a book of Mueller. And if there wasn't a book of Mueller, he would at least have been included in the faith chapter in Hebrews. But one of the things I remember being so impressed about with George Mueller, he kept a prayer journal. And when he died, his friends and family went through his prayer journals, and they discovered by studying his prayer journals that he had kept record of prayers and communications with God, interactions with God, for more than 60 years. And during the course of that 60 years worth of prayer journals, he had recorded more than 50,000 specific actions, interactions, and answered prayers with God. 50,000. And I remember when I read that, I just thought, have mercy. What a prayer giant. That's what he's known for. People call him a prayer giant. And then it occurred to me, I took out a little calculator, and I did a little bit of simple math, and I discovered something. If you and I would keep record of interactions that we have with God throughout the day for 60 years, all you'd have to do was record 2 or 3 a day, and you'd top George Mueller. It's not that big of a deal. All of us, if we just pause, can think of evidences we've had today. If we would just take 10 minutes of quiet reflection and ask everybody to take out a piece of paper and write down one thing that they can remember from this day where they had a clear reminder that God was interested in them and there was some kind of teaching moment or some kind of comfort or encouragement that came their way that they can credit God with, we'd all have something we could write down. All of us would, you know? So keeping a prayer journal helps you have stones of remembrance. That's one valuable thing about it. Another thing about keeping a prayer journal is it enables us to begin recognizing familiar patterns. Most of us are not familiar with the shepherd's voice, so we're trying to learn how to commune with him. We want to know when he's talking or when he's not. If we're not sure, but we think maybe he used one of these 7 ways of communication that I'm going to talk about in just a minute, maybe he used one of those with me this week, this day. If I'm not sure, but I write it down and I date it in my prayer journal, then over time, if that same sort of thing happens again, and over time, if it happens again, and if in hindsight I can look back and see how when that sort of teaching moment or whatever happened, then there was sort of a subsequent evidence that God really was ministering to my heart or in some way teaching me something. If I start seeing those patterns, then I become more and more familiar over the long haul. So, oh, this is him. I know this is him. I've been keeping record, and this is the way he has done this so many times in the past. He's used this kind of thing with Scripture so many times, or he's done this so many times. Prayer journals help us learn to recognize his voice. And there's one more benefit of a prayer journal that I want to bring your attention to. It slows you down. Now, this is one of the very reasons that most people object to prayer journals. They say, I don't have time for that. I am so busy, man. It's like, where am I going to find time for sitting still and doing something like that? But now just think about it for just a minute. Who would ever say they were too busy to talk with God? I mean, if I could promise you that tomorrow morning at 6:45, if I could promise you this, that God was going to call your phone to talk to you, I bet you there's nobody in this building that would be out mowing the lawn or sleeping in the bed. No, everybody, you'd be sitting by your phone. And someone comes in and goes, Mom, Dad, I need to call somebody. Say, Oh, no, don't touch that. No, don't touch that. You can talk later. I'm waiting for God. He's calling in 5 minutes. I don't want to miss this call. That's the way it would be for us, right? And you wouldn't say, well, you know, it's nice he wants to talk, but I've got a lot of stuff to do, you know, miles to go before I sleep, and I've got promises to keep, and the woods are dark and deep, and all that kind of stuff. No, we'd have time if we knew. So, it slows you down. Chuck Swindoll, he tells a story about his little girl before she was school age. He says one day he was reading a magazine, and you see an easy chair. She came running in, all excited. She jumped up into his lap, and she shoved the magazine out of his hands. And then she said to him, about as rapidly as an auctioneer might talk, she said, Daddy, I want to tell you something. I promise to tell it to you very fast. And he smiled and he said, Honey, you don't have to tell it to me fast. You can tell it to me slowly. And she said, Then, Daddy, listen slowly. Listen slowly. In the book Education, page 260, an intensity is taking possession of the world in entertainment, in business, in the very struggle to make a living. There's a terrible force that dominates body, mind, and soul. In the middle of this maddening rush, God is what? Speaking. He begs us. Get that. God begging us. Have mercy. You'd think we'd be begging God. God, he begs us to come apart and what? Commune with him. Does that sound like dialogue or monologue? Dialogue. It continues. But many, even in their seasons of devotion, fail to receive the blessing of real communion with God. Why? Because they are in too much haste. With hurried steps, they press through the circle of Christ's loving presence, pausing perhaps a moment, but not waiting. They have no time to remain with the divine teacher, and with their burdens, they return to their work. Please, not a pause for a moment in his presence, but personal contact with Christ, to sit down in companionship with him. This is our need. Does that sound like relationship talk? Oh, yeah. That's relationship talk. Job says, God does speak. Now one way, now another, though man may not perceive it. So we're going to look at 7 mediums of expression that God will use to communicate with us. As I already mentioned, there are more than 7, but I'm just going to look at 7 with you, and here's the first one, nature. Nature. The psalmist says, When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place. What is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him? When I consider your heavens. Albert Einstein is quoted as having said, even an atheist is only half an atheist at night if he goes out and looks up at the stars. Only half an atheist. Many years ago during the French Revolution, those in power were upset with the Christian element among the peasants. And they said, we will destroy your churches, we will destroy your Bibles, we will destroy your Christian literature, we will destroy everything that reminds you of God. And the peasants said, oh, you will leave us the stars. You will leave us the stars. God speaks. You know, we call it the second book, but which book was written first? Nature. Yeah, this is the second book. And God speaks through nature. And if we have ears to hear, and my goodness, right now, the last few days in this part of the world, Margie and I are hearing him talk. Whoa, your fall colors and these wonderful days. Oh, someone told me it's not always like that. But we like what we're seeing and feeling right now. I can remember Margie was taking some classes later on in life because she had postponed finishing her degree until the kids were old enough to be in school so they wouldn't have to be raised by a babysitter. And she finally started taking classwork after years of being out of college. And I remember just shuddering when I learned that she was taking a class called pre-calculus, and I just thought, oh my, oh, I'm glad it's her and not me. And you know how when you come into something that you haven't been around for years, and all these kids that you're taking the classes with, they've been taking all the different prerequisites and keeping up, and stuff is kind of fresh for them, and then they step into the next class, and then you're, you know, you're 20 years past them, and you drop in out of the blue, and she was challenged. And one day she was driving to take what might have been a final, I don't remember if it was a final or a midterm, and she was talking to the Lord while driving because she was very discouraged. She was feeling like she wasn't doing as well as she wanted to. She was really concerned about this particular test she had to take, and she was wondering if maybe she was going off down a wild goose chase and that she was pursuing a degree that God maybe didn't even have in mind for her. And in her discouragement and in those kinds of thoughts and reflections while she was driving, she began to speak to him in prayer, and she began to weep as well. You know, they say, at least in Washington, you're not supposed to be talking on a cell phone. You can get a ticket for talking on a cell phone in the state of Washington. But you know, they don't give tickets for talking to God in the state of Washington, at least not yet. And so Margie was talking to God, and she said, through her tears, she said, "Lord, I just wish I knew I was on a track and a path that you really wanted me to be on, and it would just be so good of you if you'd give me some sign, some kind of little indicator that this is a thing you're going to go through with me on together, and I'm going to be okay." And as she came up over the hill just above the school where she was going to take the test, there, after a fresh rainstorm, arching over the building she was going to take the test, was this glorious rainbow. And she said, "Oh, suddenly peace. Like a river." It was as though God just said, "Got you covered. How's a rainbow? Will that do? Is a rainbow good enough? Huh? I'm not going to let go of you. You're going to go through this. I give you my promise." God speaks through nature. So that's one other way that he speaks. A second way that God will speak, if we have ears to hear, is through providential circumstances. "In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths." Providential circumstances. If you will consider your life like a puzzle that's being put together, and then if you're looking at the shape of the puzzle and the colors maybe of the sky and the clouds that are up here in the corners, and you pick up this next piece and you say, "Okay, now if I look at the pieces of the puzzle that have been formed so far of my life, the way God's been building my life, guiding my life, shaping my life, leading my life, is this piece a logical piece to put in next?" And as you consider providential circumstances, you begin to get a feel, a conviction that God's leading and directing. Let me give you an example from my own experience. 2 years ago, we began doing this full-time revival ministry in Upper Columbia Conference. They are our sponsoring organization out there in Eastern Washington. Just a word about how it started. At the time, our conference president was Max Torkelson, and he came to us and he said these words. I'll never forget the day he said them. He said, "The Lord has put a conviction upon our hearts. We believe there needs to be a full-time focus on revival, and we believe that God's calling us to help start it with using you in a revival ministry. Would you be willing to do this?" Well, I had never talked to Max about a passion that God had been putting in my heart, and for more than 12 years had been fanning with the bellows, and the fire was getting brighter and brighter and hotter, and when he said that, I started crying. Just, it's like, whoa. I said, "You said God put a burden on your heart and told you that you were supposed to help get me started as a full-time revivalist?" He goes, "Yeah." He says, "I cannot do otherwise." Then he said, "We don't know how it's going to look because we don't know any other conferences that have a full-time revivalist. We've never done it before. We don't have a book to look at. So here's the deal. We're just going to kind of reconnoiter at the end of a year, and we'll say, what have we learned and how can we adjust our sales and, you know, how." So he said, "We don't have a whole lot of guidelines. We're just going to kind of let you do this, and we're not going to be the ones that set things up for you. We're just going to let you be the person. You know, people will contact you. They want to know more about having a revival ministry, hosting one in their church. We'll just say, call Lee. Here's his phone number. We're going to stay out of it." Now he said, "Because we don't know what it should look like, what we're guessing, we're just taking a stab. We hope maybe you could get to 20 of these in a year. You could maybe do 20 of them." Now he said, "At the end of the year, if 20 isn't good enough, you know, you could do more, or if it's too big a number and you should be doing less, we'll reevaluate. We'll just see how it all works. And we'll see how, what kind of response we get from the churches where you host those or where they host those. And if it seems to be of value to those congregations, And if it seems sustainable, because they weren't going to charge for it, they were just going to take one free will offering up at the last meeting, and whatever came in, they'd send to the conference office, and that's that. No upfront charges. So he said, 20, 20. And then he said, see you in a year. And I'm thinking, I would like a little more structure than that. And I'm not sure how to launch this thing. Well, over the course of the next 6 weeks, we ended up with four churches and their pastors talking with us about setting up a calendar to host one of these revival seminars. So we went to our first one, which was up in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. After we got done with that one, we went down to our second one. While we were at our second one, somewhere near Yakima, Washington, we got a phone call that one of the four that we had scheduled was canceling because of some health issues and some challenges at their church. So now I'm back down to three. And I remember coming home with only one left to do, and I'm supposed to have 20 in a year, and I'm thinking, I don't think this is what Max Torkelson was thinking, you know? Do a seminar, have 8 weeks off. Do a seminar, have 10 weeks off, you know? And quite frankly, I was feeling distraught. I remember the day, I'll never forget the day, it happened to be October 22nd, 2008. Maybe that number or that date means something to some of you. The great disappointment, right? Yeah. And I was seated in our house, and I was looking at this calendar for the year, and I was thinking, you know, I still need 18 seminars, I only have one. The last thing in the world that I want to do is call up a church and say, hey, how about hosting a seminar? It just doesn't work well for me to do that. It's like, you know, I'd rather swallow gravel than make those kind of phone calls. And so I remember feeling very discouraged. I got down on my knees in our house. Margie wasn't there at the time. I was just by myself. And I said, Lord Jesus, we felt like providential circumstances were wheeling us or tilting us like a marble on a board towards this hole. And we went through the hole we thought you were rolling us towards, but right now it's not looking very promising. And I'd just like to ask you, if you're really the one behind this, could you just become the booking agent? And I said, amen. Fifteen minutes later, my cell phone rang, and the guy on the other end said, I'm calling to book a revival seminar. Could we look at the calendar together? I'm going, well, that was good. Thank you. And so we started booking and figuring out a date that would work for his church and our schedule. I certainly had plenty of room. As we were talking, my cell phone had call waiting. Beep, beep. I said, just a minute, let me put you on hold. I said, this is Lee Venden. And the guy said, I'm calling to book a revival seminar. I said, oh my word, could I call you back? He said, yes. I hung up. I finished booking this guy. I dial that number back, call redial. The guy comes on the phone. We start setting up a calendar date with him. While I'm talking to him, without any break in the conversation, beep, beep, call waiting. I go, hello, this is a guy calling for a seminar. Can we book one with you? I'm going, oh, have mercy. Yeah, just a minute, I'll call you back. I finished with this guy. Five times in a row with no interruption. Boom, 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 boom. It was like God was saying, I was wondering when you were going to let me be the booking agent. I'm really into revival. And do you know what? 2 months later, that was 2008, October 22, 2008, 2 months later, God, all by himself, had booked the entire year of 2009. And a month and a half into 2009, he had filled 2010, all by himself. I think God's into revival. We have a fourth, almost a half of 2012 booked now. God's just like, so I am so excited about the fact that people here in this community are intentionally seeking revival and a closer walk with Jesus. It's just awesome. Oh, but I digress. Providential circumstances. We've got to get back on track here. That's one more way. I don't call that monologue communication. I call that dialogue communication. And God's saying, yeah, uh-huh. And he's guiding, right? Understand? A third one is music. He has put a new song in my mouth, A hymn of praise to our God. Many will see it and fear and put their trust in the Lord. A new song. You know, probably everybody here could tell you an example of how God used a song to speak to their heart. If your ear is listening, you know, there's a moment. Maybe you needed a teaching moment. Maybe you needed some encouragement. Maybe you were experiencing some sorrow, or maybe there was a hardship or some kind of a challenge and you weren't sure. And then you go to church and you hear a special number, or maybe you get in your car and you turn on a Christian radio, or you pop in a CD, or you, you know, you hear a song and you say to yourself, unbelievable, that song was just what I need. That was like meat in due season. Guess what? It wasn't an accident. Oh, no. No, the Good Shepherd has your number, and he used that song to let you know he's dialed in on you, and he's wanting you to hear that, yeah, he's got your back, he's got your front, he's got you covered, he's going to take you through, and that song helped you. You know, just recently, we were preparing to take off for 3 months. We live most of the year in a fifth wheel, and we're going to take off on a three-month circuit before we were back home again. And I have to tell you that was somewhat intimidating to think about, being gone that long, especially because at this point, my mother needs my help to help give care to my father, who's not doing well. And to go off and leave her without anyone, to be in the corner there with her, was a daunting thought. And I remember thinking, boy, Lord. And one morning, as I was there with my quiet time with Jesus, and I was praying and I was lifting up to him this thing about how, you know, we're about to go and we're going to be gone for 3 months. And it just feels a little bit, I don't know, Lord. And as I was saying those things to him, suddenly he popped a tune into my head. I didn't even hear this on a CD. It just popped into my head. And as I thought about the tune, have you ever had that kind of experience where a tune goes into your head before the words do, and you're not even sure what the tune was, and then all of a sudden you think about the words, and you go, oh, how cool is that? You know, like the first snowflakes start coming down, and as you're walking along outside and the flakes are coming, you're going, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And then you see, oh, wow, how is it that I'm singing this? It's looking like a lot like Christmas as the snow falls. Is this a coincidence? Well, that was that kind of thing. I was praying about this trip that was about to be launched, and all of a sudden a tune goes through my head. I started trying to figure what was the tune, and suddenly I realized God had popped it in there. It was like he hit play on my hard drive, you know, my media player, boom, and it was a song by Steve Green. Let me show you the lyrics. Give me your ears to hear your spirit. Give me ears to hear your spirit. Give me feet to follow through. Give me passion for your glory and the faith to follow you. And I will go where there are no easy roads. I will leave the comforts that I know. I will go and I will let this journey be my home. I will go. I will go. And I said, Lord Jesus, thank you for that song. Thank you for putting that song in my head just now and letting me know it's going to be okay. You're going to watch over my dad and my mom. And I will go. He uses music. Another one that he will use. People. Each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. He'll use people. Just like music, everybody here can tell you a story about somebody coming along at just the right moment. Maybe it was a phone call. Maybe it was a visit to your house. Maybe it was meeting someone at a cash register in a store. Maybe it was a teacher in school. Maybe it was someone in the foyer after church. Maybe it was someone that came to work to get something that you served and then you had a conversation. Whatever it was, and God used them to bring you just the meat in due season that you needed. Now, if your ear is cocked and trained to hear the Good Shepherd, you don't make a mistake about this. It wasn't an accident. God orchestrated it. He had your number. He knows your address. It wasn't an accident. Back in 2002, I have in the front of my Bible, I have 9 quotations that I have gathered over the years just from reading, gems that I have put there. I'm not going to read them to you, nor am I going to even reference, except to say this. All 9 of them could be summarized like this. They say this kind of a message. Unless Jesus is seen, as the heart and core, the central theme and the pivotal message of each of our doctrines, then the doctrines are not being taught correctly. That's what it said. I have 9 of those. And I'm thinking to myself, wow. Because I'm acquainted with a lot of fundamental beliefs where Jesus might be postscripted at the end, just kind of tail there, just kind of like, oh yeah. But to see him as the heart and core and central pivotal theme of the whole doctrine and then take the doctrine and postscript it to Jesus, I wasn't used to that kind of a thing. And I carried those around in my Bible for a long time, and finally one day I called my dad. And I read him my quotes. And then I said, Dad, I want to challenge you something. I said, why don't you do a series with 27 meetings? You have any idea why I thought that number? In which you show that Jesus is the heart and core and central pivotal theme of every one of them. Why don't you do that? And my dad said, no, because I'm retired. Besides, he said, they were your quotes. You do it. I said, Dad, they're not my quotes. They were somebody else's words. I just have them in my Bible. Well, he said. No, I said, look it. How about you do half of them and I'll do half of them? He thought about that for a little while and he said, put me down. And so he came out second year that we were in Walla Walla and he did the series with me. He and I had the privilege. It's the last thing he has recorded. And I'm grateful that I got the privilege of doing that one thing with him. But while we were doing the series, I got a letter in the mail. It was so nice. It was actually a letter that had been written to the conference president, but whoever wrote the letter thought it'd be nice to send me a copy of it too, so I would know what the president had received. It was thoughtful of them. And it was signed, so I want to give credit. It was actually signed by more than 6 names. All actually influential people in our congregation. You know, I get a lot of letters that aren't signed, you know. Wimps. Cowards. This is what I do with them. Anyway, this letter was signed. It was written to my president. And it said this. It said, all we ever hear about down here is Jesus. We are hungry for some good old-fashioned real Adventist preaching. Now, what's the implication of that? That good, old-fashioned Adventist preaching is not going to be centered on Jesus. I didn't get depressed because I felt personally attacked or wounded. I got depressed because several key leaders in my church didn't see Jesus as being worth making front and center of everything. They just didn't. And it made me sad. Just made me sad. My heart was aching. I went home that day. I didn't tell anybody about it. I went home that day. The next day I came to work. And when I came in the door, came into my office, there was a plant sitting on my desk. And in that plant, there was this little card. And it was anonymous. There was no name. But there was another card down below accompanying the plant. Now the card on the plant was a text. It was 2 Kings 6:16, which says, they who are with us are greater than they who are with them. And the note card that was given said, please never stop preaching sermons all about Jesus. And they didn't even know that I'd gotten that letter. And I thought, there you go, Jesus. You have my address. And you used people to communicate to me. One more way that God will use to speak to us if we have our ears trained to listen. A fifth way that God will use to speak to us is through inspired reading material. A word fitly spoken or written is like apples of gold in pictures of silver. If you are in the custom of reading, especially inspirational literature, you will be astounded, perhaps, at the number of times you'll come across a paragraph that was just tailored for you that day. It didn't happen by accident, friends. God used that inspired rate reading that you were doing. And he said, here, I'm going to give a message to you. And you pick that book up, and you pick up where the bookmark was, and you start reading. I mean, it's just an amazing thing. I keep a prayer journal, been doing it for years, and I'm going to read you something I wrote in one of my prayer journal entries just the day before we were going to leave on another seminar in our fifth wheel. As we first started into these seminars, every time we would start out for a new one, something would go wrong. Every time. All kinds of things went wrong, including blowing out a transmission when we were 2 miles away from the church we were headed for. Just all kinds of things. And at first, we were just caught off guard and totally unsurprised. You know, like, what? Where did that come from? And then after about, 11 of those, Margie and I kind of went, there's an enemy that doesn't want revival happening. And he's doing what he can to discourage people who are trying to work to help churches grow in that way. And so I wrote this note in my prayer journal. Lord Jesus, we have seen how the enemy causes dark clouds to descend over us every time we are to leave for another seminar. Clearly, we are no match for his cunning and his power, but you are. Would you please raise up a standard against him and send us forth as more than conquerors? That's what I wrote in my prayer journal, and I have a date for it. Then I picked up the book I was reading at that moment, and I opened it where the bookmark was. The very first paragraph said these words, Great Controversy, page 632. Want to see this thing? This is just astounding. As the wrestling ones urge their petitions before God, words fall upon the ear, stand fast. Help is coming. Lo, I am with you. Be not afraid. You are not warring against untried enemies. I have fought this battle on your behalf, and in my name, you are more than conquerors. I said, please send us off as more than conquerors. First paragraph I read, the precious Savior will send help just when we need it. I would call that dialogue prayer. Not monologue prayer. Dialogue prayer. A sixth way that God will use to speak to us, Scripture. Now here we come. If these were in order of importance, this would have been number one. Scripture. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path. Scripture. This is the most dependable, surefire way to hear from Jesus. Right here. It doesn't get any better than this. It's called the Word of God, right? The Word. Notice this quotation from Testimonies. Volume 6. The Bible is God's voice speaking to us just as surely as though we could hear it with our ears. If we realize this, with what awe would we open God's Word? And with what earnestness would we search its precepts? The reading and contemplation of the Scriptures would be regarded as an audience with the Infinite One. It's His Word. It's that real. Now, sometimes God will use His Word in, I would call, kind of vague generalities. You'll read a story, you read a passage, and as you kind of meditate on that passage, the whole story in its totality, you say, oh, I see something in this for me. I see in this story a lesson for me today. How cool of God to kind of open my understanding to that. I really needed that counsel, that instruction, that guidance. It's good. Sometimes it's that way. Other times, it's specific. Like the verse is so spot on that you say to yourself, this is like God told Jeremiah, I want you to take this down for Lee Venden. He's going to need this in a few thousand years. I remember one time, it was a Thursday, I woke up. I woke up with a bad attitude. And I'll tell you why. It was going to be the first day of nominating committee. And I had a bad attitude. Now, it wasn't because I don't like to make phone calls. It's because I can't tell you how sad it makes me to call people on the phone and say, hey, what could you do to make a difference for the Lord Jesus in our church this coming year? And hear people say, oh, I don't think this year. We've got a lot on our plates right now, and maybe some other year we can help, but this year's just not going to be one of those years. But thanks for thinking of us. Goodbye. That hurts. It doesn't hurt because I'm feeling rejected. No. What if the Lord Jesus had said, as he looked at planet Earth, you know, it's not real convenient for me right now. Maybe I really don't have the time for redemption. The incarnation is rather awkward. You know, I mean, I've got a lot on my plate up here. I'm keeping the universe going. You know, what if the Lord Jesus had that attitude? Where would we be? And so then I get so sad when I hear people who can't even give a little to make a difference for the one who gave everything for them. So that makes me sad. So I had a bad attitude. So I woke up with a bad attitude. It's like, oh man, couldn't I just go back to sleep and wake up in 3 weeks, 4 weeks, and it's done, and it's over, and it's behind me? And then I started grousing at God. Do you know that grousing at God, it's safe to have an attitude with God. Do you know that? You can have an attitude with God, and it doesn't penalize you. You know, because I'm thinking about it for just a minute. If you don't say it, he already knew you were thinking it. You know? So, you know, who are you fooling? Really, you know? So this is what I said. I said, you know, Lord, I'll tell you what. Today, I could use some meat in due season. I could really use some encouragement today. But fat chance I'm going to find any, because I'm going through the Bible sequentially, and right now, I'm stuck in Chronicles. That's what I said. And if my ear had been tuned, I would have heard a deep chuckle overhead, because God knew where my bookmark was. I didn't. Let me show you what I read first when I opened my bookmark. This is it. This is unbelievable. 1 Chronicles 28:20. Be strong and courageous. Do the work. Do not be afraid or discouraged. The Lord God is with you. He will not fail you or forsake you until all the work for the service of the temple of the Lord is finished. Whoa, it's kind of like, get a life, Lee. I'm not going to forsake you. Well, you call that monologue or dialogue prayer? I call that dialogue. God using his word to speak to us. One more. Thoughts and impressions. Now, before I say anything about thoughts and impressions, one caution. If you are not in a daily, meaningful, ongoing, regular fellowship with Christ, if you're not spending time in his word, if you're not talking to him in prayer, if the three legs of the stool aren't a meaningful part of your day and your routine and your week, and if you haven't been cultivating to hear his voice in these other areas we've already been talking about, forget this one. Because thoughts and impressions, the devil could be working with you on that one. You've got to be grounded in God's word and in a relationship with him before thoughts and impressions could be valid. But if you are grounded, sometimes he gives you thoughts and impressions that astound you. One day in one of my churches I pastored, a woman brought me a book. She said, Pastor Lee, I want to share a book with you. I'm going to share it because I can't give it to you. I'd like to be able to give it to you, but I can't because it's out of print. It's a wonderful book, though. It's short meditations on the life of Jesus based on passages of Scripture where the author just meditates on it and then kind of unpacks that passage in a meditative way. And I know you'd like them because I know how much you love stories about Jesus. And now, this author, I went to school with him. His name is Kenneth Fields. And I went to school with him when we were in academy together. He went on to graduate and become an English teacher at one of our academies. And in the course of his work there, he wrote this book. It's entitled Him, H-I-M, and I want to share it with you. Now, she said it's kind of sad because Kenneth Fields eventually left the church, left the school, left family and friends, left God, and went off to the far country. But that doesn't mean the book isn't worthwhile. I know you'll love the book. Give it back to me when you get done. And I don't even know where Kenneth Fields lives now. Someone told me he lives out in the Olympic Peninsula, out there in the very edge of Western Washington, but I don't even know that for sure. Anyway, enjoy. And she left. And I took the book, pale blue book with yellow letters, Him, H-I-M. And I set it on a shelf right across from my desk. I set it sideways in front of all the other books that were stacked on the shelf like this. So it's there at the front. And that book sat there, right across from my desk, for 2 years. 2 years. And one day, 2 years later, I'm looking at that book one morning, and I'm going, oh my. She asked me to give that back when I was done reading. Huh. It's 2 years later. I haven't even read it yet. I got to get this book back to her. Oh man, if I give it back to her, she's going to say, so how did you like it? You sure had enough time to read it. And I can't bear to tell her, well, I haven't read it yet. Could you give me another couple years? So I thought, maybe I'll read a chapter or two so that I can say to her, well, I remember really liking the first couple chapters. So I opened the book up and I began reading the first couple of chapters. I'll never forget what happened. The second chapter, was a story of Simeon, the one who God had said, you will not die before you see the Messiah. You'll hold him in your arms. And he had meditated, the author had meditated on that passage, and he told the story in such a beautiful way of this elderly man and how that the Holy Spirit impressed him and how he, under the promptings of the Holy Spirit, was guided to be in the right place at the right time. And it was so special. And when it was over and he had held the baby, he went back home and he sat down on a bench in front of his house with the warm sun on his face, and he closed his eyes and he said to himself, oh, it is so good to have held the Messiah. I think now in the warm sun, I will just close my eyes and I will lean back and I will rest for just a little while. Just a little while. And I put the book down and I was weeping. I was thinking, how cool is that? I like how he pictured the Holy Spirit guiding that man. And then, out of the blue, like being blindsided, this distinct impression entered my mind. Call Kenneth Fields right now and tell him how much this book means to you. And I'm thinking, what? It came again. Call Kenneth Fields right now and tell him how much this book means to you. I'm going, God, is that you, really? I mean, come on. I don't even know Kenneth Fields. I have no clue where he lives. You certainly aren't. This is just a wild thought. I must have eaten too many burritos or something. This is not you. No, it couldn't be you. Call Kenneth Fields right now. Folks, I don't know how you think in your brain. I don't think commands to myself. I don't. I think maybe I'll go get a drink. My brain doesn't say, Lee, go get a drink right now. But it doesn't work that way. But this is the way it was coming in. Call Kenneth Fields right now. I argued. I said, Lord, I feel like an idiot. If that's you, I'm going to feel like an idiot. I want to call up some guy I don't know and say, hi, my name is Lee Venden. I have a message from God from you. Call him. I don't know his phone number. Dial information. So I dialed information. 1-360-555-1212. That's the area code for the Western Peninsula. Operator comes on. Can I help you? Yeah, I'm looking for a guy. I don't even know who he is. I don't know where he lives. Maybe somewhere in Western Washington, someone told me. His name is Kenneth Fields. Do you happen to have a phone number? One moment, please. I have two Kenneth Fields, one in Port Angeles and one in Squim. Which one do you want? I said, I'll take them both. She said, all right. She gave me the numbers. Then I hung up. Great. I was hoping I wouldn't get any numbers. Which one should I dial? I decided I'd dial the one from Squim first because that was closer to where I lived. So I begin to dial the number, and as I dial the number, I'm thinking, oh man, I hope you're not home, buddy, because I'm just going to leave a message on your voicemail and I'll be done. Phone got picked up on the other end. Voice said, hello. I said, are you Kenneth Fields? Yes. I said, you don't know me. My name is Lee Venden, and I'm not a telemarketer, so please don't hang up yet. He said, yes. I said, we've never met, but I need to ask you a question. By any chance, did you ever write a book entitled Him? He said, yes. I said, this is going to sound really weird, okay? I mean, it sounds weird to me, so it's going to sound doubly weird to you. But the reason I'm calling you is because I just started reading it, and God told me to tell you how much it meant to me. So here I am. Pretty bizarre, isn't it? And all of a sudden, I heard this man start sobbing on the other end. Start sobbing. I said, are you okay? He said, yeah, just a minute. I'll tell you, just a minute. Don't hang up. And he's on the other end gasping. Finally, he gets control. And this is what he says. He says, I have wandered so far from home that I have done the prodigal son times 10. And he said, I figured for sure there's no waiting father for me. And he said, it's been getting pretty lonely in the pig pen. And I've been wishing I could go home. But he said, I just didn't feel like he'd ever have time for me. He says, I haven't talked to God for so long that I almost forgot how to do it. But he said, this morning, I got down on my knees and I said, God, if you're out there and you listen to prodigals, I'd sure like to know that I ever did anything in my life that made you smile or was of some value to you. That would be encouragement to me that maybe I might come home again. And while I'm on my knees, the phone rings and you tell me I have a message from God. You wrote a book. He said, I will be in the Squim Seventh-day Adventist Church next Sabbath. Thank you for calling me. I later asked him if I could have permission to put his book, which is out of print, on our website. And so you can read it for yourself on our website. I'll tell you more about our website at another meeting. But anyway, 2 years. I'm thinking I dropped the ball. 2 years. But 2 years is when it was that Kenneth was on his knees praying for a sign that God said, come home. Thoughts and impressions, God will even use them. So will you train your ear to listen long enough to hear him? Psalms 27, 7 and 8. This is what I pray is your prayer. Hear me as I pray, O Lord. Be merciful and answer me. My heart has heard you say, come and talk with me. And my heart responds, Lord, I'm coming. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, how wonderful that you want to commune with us, that you want to manifest yourself to us, and that if we would be still, we'd know, we'd hear, we would commune with you. So Lord, as the disciples said, teach us to pray. Teach us to pray dialogue prayer. And thank you for making it possible. In Jesus' name, amen.